I am Venkatramana from HLA, Hyderabad. In this talk, we will be discussing about the various machine learning techniques that you can apply on real world data. And here the importance is on social networking sites, because many of us work on spend a lot of time on that. This demo is it's a demo, and it's going to be about how you're going to make your own learning algorithm for how you think about setting your privacies among your friends in social networks. So real world data, I mean, there's lots of cases that you can say the data is real. So blogs, forums, tweets, all these contents of data. So what we are concerned about our own data at various places is privacy, right? And how are we going to share data, and how vulnerable are we in passing some comments on blogs and etc. So with respect to social networking site, social networking is already available. I mean, you do all social network thing all the time, but we have something called social networking sites that we are going to use especially for networking like Facebook, Orkut and MySpace. And we are concerned in a lot of ways about the information that they are going to share on it, right? So the aim of this talk is to create an environment where you form your own rules, right? Because different people have different views, social views, right? Some want to share everything on the web, some like to hide everything. I mean, depends on how you set your privacy settings on social networks. So, and all this happens because of some intuitiveness that you have in your brain, right? You can't explicitly specify it, like these are my rules. So, according to this rule, so I share some information with XYZ friend, and according to some other rule, I don't share some other information. Right? So these are intuitive, and how you are going to realize them yourself. So we are going to use a technique called active learning in this, and the idea, the place in which this is useful, is that if you have a few training data set, like few training instances. Like it means a few examples of how you classify the data, and there are lots of information where you can't label the data. Like, for example, you might know a few of your friends on your social networking sites, so and you know them about them very well, right? So you want to set your privacy settings for them in a way you share everything or you don't share. You know about them well, but how about the rest of them? Suppose an average Facebook user has 150 friends, and maybe you might know 10 or 20 friends. Well, too well. So you might just set some settings for these friends, but you don't know anything about the other guys. Right? So this is one scenario in which you can use active learning. Okay? And here, actually, as it says, we have few labeled training instances, a few of your friends that you know there, and most of them are unknown. Like you have to train the privacy settings for the rest of the guys. So active learner, here you are going to use a person, like what we call a human annotator, in making this work. So this is one scenario, and there are different ways that you can start learning in using active learning. First one is membership persistence. This starts with almost no examples at all, right? Right from the first training example, it's kind of a questionnaire, right? You put the question to your friends and ask him for some input, like how do you want to share your data with so and so friend? So this is like kind of a questionnaire. So in the first approach, you have no concept, no information at all. But we are going to concentrate on the third part, which is pool-based active learning here for our demo. So and it uses uncertainty sampling. So these are some of the questions that you can have here. So What do you have in common with your friend? And the answer can be, he's my classmate, or he's my family friend, or anything less. That is. And maybe you can take some time and discuss the question altogether. Or you can specify something as the answer, XYZ. And we are going to use this labeling information as the attributes for the training data, which is called the feature vector. Okay. So this is pseudo algorithm. So L we call as the known data, training data, and we have a lot of unknown data, unlabeled instances. It's called U. So we will be using a classifier. This classifier can be anything again. So you can use a decision tree, an AV biased approach, or neural networks. That's your choice. So and we want to use a classifier to train the initial set of data. Once the classifier learns something, it asks you questions by choosing the unlabeled examples. Okay. So once it poses a question to you, and you will be answering that question. So it happens in rounds. After the first round, maybe you have provided answers for some more friends, okay? And these will be included in the L set. Okay? So again, the classifier gets trained on all these instances, so it becomes more robust now because it uses more training data, and there will be another round in which you can apply. Maybe you can stop. You can set the after two rounds, you can stop the algorithm and the learning that it has made. You can use that learning to set the privacy preferences for the rest of your friends. So you can form friend groups. You don't know, like, you have, the answers that you gave from the groups, and this is somewhat similar. For example, you will be extracting the features which will be given by you itself. For example, you set a level friend as a family member, so that forms a group. That is one of the features in this feature stack. Okay. And after some questionnaires, you want to stop this, and you are going to use that algorithm to train the rest of the information. And some concepts we need to know for starting this is gene impurity. Gene impurity is, I'll be taking this example to explain that. So for example, this data set, it learns if a new user comes to the site. Okay, it can use this already historical data, or existing historical data like Slashdot. The reference to that site is Slashdot or Google or Dig. These are all the information that you can have collected over time. And where he has come from and what he has read, whether he has read it frequently, ask questions and all. So, and ultimately the service he has chosen on your site. Right? It's a premium, basic, or anything. None. So, for example, if you see the premium levels, there are only 3 among 15. So if a new user comes, and if you say gene impurity, the expected error rate, so if you want to classify the new user among these subscriptions, so if you put him on a premium, that is 1/5 chance that he will be put in a correct place, right? So 80% of the time he will be wrong. So this is what gene impurity explains. So entropy is more or less the same, but it uses logs. So the difference between entropy and gene impurity is that entropy penalizes, it is more robust, like the entropy score that it gives increases very little in magnitude from each time. And we will be using classification and regression trees. So we will be using decision tree algorithm for our training. So our application data for our purpose might look like this. So these IDs are nothing but your friends. Okay, friend number 123 is assigned to sponsor group and is not in group 2, and you want to share your data with or not? Yes, share. So this is some of this sample data that we are going to go. Okay, stop it now. So these are some of my friends that are retrieved using open session API from Orkut actually. And I already set some values for these friends. So you can see these are all the your personal profile items that you want to share or not to share. So I want to share my date of birth, religion, and email with this friend. So also I have a feature called rating here. I'm getting a rating of 70, and I'm assigning a project group. Okay. And this record tells here that this is used for training. So this is a training data that I'm going to use for class. And there is another friend. So he's also said these are settings for sharing supplies. And these are the things that I want to share with him. And he's allocated the SRM group. And I'm going to take one more friend here. One more best sign. And mark him for training. So things like I'm going to share this thing of phone number, email, and So actually I'm going to delete the last record. So we have three friends and we are going to train an algorithm with this as a training data and see if other friends who have similar attributes have their privacy preferences set. I mean, for example, I'm going to take this friend and add him to project group. I don't want to mark him for training because this should be automatically trained and this potential should be set. So I'm going to save him. Take another friend. I'm not going to mark it for anything. So now that I have three records of training data and assigned some groups for non-training data set as well. So now I'm going to train this algorithm. Let's see if it can classify these friends who are not marked for training as well. I'm going to classify this friend. Suppose this friend is a new friend request that you're going to get on the social networking site, and you have assigned her a group of right, and then if you have the training algorithm, going to classify it and you are going to share your phone and email. So the algorithm has taking the same preferences that I have set for another friend for subject, and they can supply this. And it is just one to one here. It looks like I've used the same group and for this guy and this girl. So it's a direct match. It looks like that, but it can be more complex also. You can add one or more groups for each person. And I'm not using the parameter rating or the ranking in my as a feature in my learning algorithm. So if you use that as well, so your algorithm might be more open. And I'm going to class to another friend now. Check. He said just well. Yes. He said because these are the same things that I have shared with another friend. For Boston. And similarly for the first now. So these are the settings that we have got. And let's see the results. So these are the groups that I have taken, project, SRM and SSSG. These are the features of the feature vector that we are talking about. And the decisions have to be made on each of your profile settings, like date of birth, zip, region, and port, and email. So the records that are generated for each friend, you see, and when you see the training that's actually going on, so if you see this, and so these are the records that are provided from each of the friends. The first record is from this, it's from Vasu. The second record is from Sijit. The third one is from Maharish. So we are going to use these three records, and we have formed this tree. Okay. So the tree makes a decision on one. Okay. If the label of one is yes, what is one? One is the number of features. So this is 0 and this is 1. So SRM group, if he is assigned to SRM group, then you follow the true branch and you are not going to share it. So this is the count of number of times you have contributed. And if you want to follow the false branch, then you are going to share it twice. So if you have a new friend, it will just check if he is of the SRM group, and if it is yes, and it's not going to share your data back. The same way for zip code as well. So this is the tree that's for zip code. Zip code we are not sharing any time. So this is the only record that we have. Not share 3 times. So we have another tree for religion. And we are going to share it if 0 is this. So 0 is project. So if any person is in a project group, we are not going to share our religion with this friend. So these are the results. So we are talking about the feature vector here. This is the feature vector. And this is understood as 0, 1 and 2 by the algorithm that we are going to use. The goal is to share or not to share on each of these items. So there will be a different tree for each of these profile settings. So for data birth, this is the training data that you have given for each of these friends. So this is the tree that we have got for data. And for zip code as well, this is the same thing. These are the end results. So we can use a classifier other than decision trees in our approaches, like neural networks or maybe as any other algorithm for this purpose. And so most of the examples of this demo are taken from Collective Intelligence Book, like Toby Sagar. And some of the ideas are provided by the paper published in World Wide Web Community Conference. So, any question?
Yeah, so I would like to understand that active learning is
a I'm not using actually, I'm not giving any questions to myself, right? So I'm not using active learning, but you can use many. For example, so I'm explaining the second stage of your process. So the actual learning is meaning how you are going to train your algorithm. That is what I'm explaining. The classification part in active learning is what I'm explaining. So you can create an UI and post some questions.
But how on a real world application, isn't it going to be very difficult? Very slow process when you are having a lot of human annotators sitting in.
No. For this, that's why I'm taking this example specifically. It's about your own algorithm. You're going to train on your own data, right? So ultimately, you get some hidden rules. Okay. For example, it's not often that in a real world situation that you get a friend every minute. Maybe once in 2 days you get a new friend request. But you already have an algorithm that is trained on the past data, like past friends. So it only makes sense when you get a friend request, you're just going to set in a group. That's the only thing that you're going to set and accept this friend request. The algorithm automatically sets the privacy settings for your new friend. Thank you.